as we normally do for the ceremonial opening. It says here, Houses of Parliament, Jamaica, the opening of the 2016-2017 session of the Senate and the House of Representatives. So this building was first used on October 26, 1960, and it took over from Headquarters House, which is just next door, which is now the Jamaica National Heritage Trust. So, Guard Commander, when the Guard of Honor marches on, which is formed this morning by the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, will be Major Sean Fortnum. And the 2nd Battalion Jamaica Regiment commanding officer this time round is Lieutenant Colonel Johnson, Rowan Johnson. To the northern end of Duke Street, you will see those persons who are supporters of the Jamaica Labour Party. They are gathered there at the northern end of Duke Street, and strict rules are now being implemented, as they used to be many years ago. So there can be no gathering for 200 yards from Gordon House. To the southern end, we have the members, or the supporters rather, of the People's National Party, and those strict rules also are in place, no closer than 200 yards to the entrance of Gordon House. Now we see the members of the Jamaica Defense Force taking their place. The street liners will be in place, and of course a guard of honor will be there as well. As soon as the proceedings are completed here, then all persons will be inside the chambers who are part of this morning's activities for the throne speech, which of course will be delivered by our Governor General, His Excellency, the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Allen. The arrivals will come in a guests, members of the judiciary, members of the diplomatic corps, and other special invited guests who will come. They need to be seated about 20 minutes before the Governor General arrives. We will have the Commissioner of Police arriving and the Chief of Defense Staff, and then we will have members of the Senate and members of Parliament, and of course the Governor General will arrive to inspect the Guard of Honor, and music will be provided by the mass bands of the Jamaica Defense Force. So I'm going to hand you back to some shots of what's happening as we prepare on Duke Street. It's a hot day. There's a slight breeze, as you can see if you're looking at any of the leaves in that acacia tree over there, a slight breeze to cool things down, but I think everything as normal, because we normally handle these things with such great care and professionalism, will happen momentarily. So when next you see me, I'll be giving you commentary on what is happening with the Guard of Honor. Street liners are in place. Those are the men in the scarlet tunics that are already in place, and they're at both ends. I'm not certain if you're seeing just sort of the picture with where I am speaking from, or also if you're getting a chance to see what's happening on the southern end of Duke Street. So we have other colleagues here as well. Very close at hand is another media house, and perhaps you can hear some of their company. We can see members arriving at this time with family, and that's the President of the Senate arriving there, Tom Tavares Finson, and he has in his party about four persons. They, of course, will be taken on the inside, but then he will also make a proper and official entrance to Gordon House when that time is right. So have a look-see on what's happening to the rest of Duke Street as we prepare. I'll be right back with more commentary momentarily. I'm Faye Ellington. Of course, the bandmaster. Staff sergeant here, so you can listen to what's happening there. Gardens of Parliament, which is right across from Gordon House. You now see members of the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment. They'll be forming the Guard of Honor this morning. Their commanding officer is Lieutenant Colonel Ron Johnson, and the Guard Commander is Major Sean Faulkner. Here they are with the crisp boots on the asphalt. And perhaps you are seeing at this time these two colors. They are called colors. That's the voice of the Guard Commander, Major Sean Faulkner, belting out those commands. The two colors you're seeing, the regimental colors, which is the maroon, which is the regimental color of the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, and what appears and looks like the Jamaica flag, but it isn't, the Queen's color. And the Queen's color is on parade this morning because the Governor General will be in attendance. And of course, we know the Governor General is the Queen's representative in Jamaica. So they are now in open order as the directions given and they address. You hear the leather soles on the asphalt really sounding as if there's a heavy rainfall for some, whereas for others it might come across as if you have pebbles in a container and you're shaking them vigorously. But this is how they dress and prepare themselves to ensure that they are in a straight line. So the color ensigns have the colors on display this morning. The Queen's color, which looks like the Jamaica flag, but if you'll notice it isn't because there are the tassels around. And that will in fact be dipped to the point where it touches the asphalt. Now we know that the Jamaican flag ought not ever to touch the ground, but out of deference to the Governor General when he arrives, the flag will be dipped to touch the asphalt. The regiment, the beg your pardon, the Queen's color. So don't go confuse that with the Jamaican flag. The troops that have formed the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaican Regiment this morning are formed up. And of course, complete with their dress uniform, their scarlet tunics. The checkering on the band. The SLRs with the fixed bayonets. There we see the Guard Commander, Major Sean Faulkner. And so,
stand easy!
And now they can stand at ease until the arrival of significance begins. We're expecting that we will be seeing women really nattily attired this morning, and so too the men. It usually is an occasion for fashion to be on display, even though it is also such an important start to the legislative year, because what is indeed happening is the throne speech will be read by the Governor General, and that will signal the start of the legislative year. And if I could give you perhaps in a while the dates of the various presentations that will be held in the budget presentation. So we will speak about that momentarily, so you can have an idea when everything will be conducted, and that will be on April 14, which is what we're doing here now at 2 o'clock, the tabling of the Avenue Expenditure Base. May 3 to 5 at 10, the Ceiling Finance Committee is scheduled to meet. May 12 at 2 p.m., the opening of the budget debate. May 17 at 2 p.m., the budget debate, opposition spokesperson on finance. May 19, 2 p.m., the budget debate, and of course that now the leader of the opposition. May 24, in the budget debate, the Prime Minister will make his presentation at 2 o'clock. And May 25 at 2 o'clock, the budget debate closes and appropriation bill passed. So those are some dates you ought to bear in mind. May 3 to 5, May 12, May 17, May 19, May 24, and May 25. So we are now awaiting the special arrivals, and those will take place momentarily. So when we look at that color party, the color ensigns or ensigns and the escorts, these are two officers who have been given the honor this morning to carry the colors of the unit. And I did mention earlier on about the Queen's collar symbolizing the monarch as Jamaica's head of state, and of course with the Governor General making an appearance here this morning, those colors are in order to be on parade. So with the guard of honor in position, we now await the arrivals, and as we can see, they have in fact started. The commissioner of police has just arrived. The parade area, while the commissioner takes his place as he awaits the arrival of the Chief of Defense Staff, Commissioner of Police Dr. Carl Williams. The Chief of Defense Staff will be arriving in short order. If you're just joining us, welcome to the ceremonial opening of Parliament. And of course, this is the beginning of the 2016-2017 session of the Senate and the House of Representatives and the delivery of the throne speech. Permanent secretaries are going by. I'd like to acknowledge them and other persons who have come. Mrs. Henry passing by, Minister Mike Henry's wife, as they make their way into the chambers. They will of course be seated in the gallery. All visitors and special guests. There'll be the members of the Senate, the members of the House of Representatives, and special guests, the judiciary, the diplomatic corps, other persons, perhaps from academia, will be here. And Mrs. Donna Parchment Brown now makes her way past as she goes on into the House. Gordon House. Here's another outrider coming, and this time we're signaling the arrival of the Chief of Defense Staff. Major Sean Faulkner belts out his command. The Chief of Defense Staff exits his unit, and he also now makes his way to the holding area to join the Commissioner of Police as they await. There he makes his way on the red carpet. The Lieutenant Colonel Ron Johnson is the commanding officer of the 2nd Battalion Jamaica Regiment, making their way now to the saluting dais. He mounts the saluting dais. Salutes the Guard of Honor. Of course, this is a very important moment for him, to ensure that everything is in order.
So we
see. Morning, Duke. Morning, Colonel. Morning. So the Chief of Defense Staff, Major General Anthony Anderson, now returns to the holding area of, in anticipation of the other arrivals. And very well, sir. We see Mr. Robertson passing by and other members. Hello, Mr. O'Rain. You're going on in. Wonderful. So you see, we have special invited guests who have come by. Members of the civil service are also here. Very important persons who are here because this is indeed a significant occasion. All ceremonial openings of Parliament, very important. Good morning. So in a short while, you will be, in fact, seeing the gathering of the members of the Senate, the members of the House of Representatives, and of course, we will have the arrival of the Governor General. We see the Speaker of the House. How are you doing, sir? Mr. Charles, how are you?
Doing greater than ever.
Oh, I thank you very much, sir. Do have a wonderful day. That's Colonel Charles, the Speaker of the House, just making his way in. There's a little, an annoying car alarm that's going on, but that thank God. Hello, good morning, sir. Just to give you an idea of what's happening, the supporters of both parties are at a good distance away, 200 yards, and so they can see what is happening, but they cannot, in fact, get too close to Gordon House, which these are the rules, and they are being, in fact, ensured that they are implemented, and so that we have everything moving smoothly. Good morning, sir. Good morning, ma'am. Bright sunny morning, hardly a cloud in the sky. As we prepare, the sun is almost overhead at 21 minutes to 11 this time. And if you are tuning in to the civics of this country, and you perhaps want to know a little bit more, there are 63 members of the House of Representatives. That's allowed by the Constitution. Currently, the government holds 32 seats and the opposition 31. We can see at the far end, on the southern end, members of the judiciary making their way in, gowned. We see Justice Hilary Phillips. And the, oh, I'm seeing now the Chief Justice. Chief Justice is right. This is Zayla McCullough. Flanked by other members of the judiciary, Justice Hilary Phillips. Making their way into Gordon House at this time. Yes, and there are 14 first-timers currently in the House of Representatives, 11 in the governing party and 3 from the opposition. 4 of the first-timers, a member of parliament, are women who are all from the government. And that is another bit of information that you might find very, very helpful. Here is something else that is a first. The Most Honorable Juliet Holmes. It's the first time that Jamaica has found her where there is someone who is a member of parliament who is also the wife of the prime minister. Now, as member of parliament, you're just Mrs. Juliet Holness, but not so in this case because she is the wife of the prime minister. So on very official occasions such as this and other occasions, she's the Most Honorable Mrs. Andrew Holness. Because that Most Honorable is from the fact that her husband is Prime Minister of Jamaica, and he did in fact accept the order of the nation, and once you have the order of the nation, you are referred to as the most honorable. So the governors general, past and present, and the prime ministers, past and present, and their spouses are referred to as the most honorable. In the case of the women, of course, for official occasions, they will take the gentleman's first name, so the most honorable, Mrs. Andrew Holness. How are you doing, sir? Good morning. Seeing Mr. Amos, who himself contested a seat, just passing by just now. We are now round about getting up to 10:46. We should see at this point those members of the Senate and members of the House of Representatives. And you can hear that there is a little bit of some welcoming noise coming from the north end, and that is where the members of the supporters, rather, of the Jamaica Labour Party are gathered. And so when they see members of Parliament and other persons who are part of this occasion, ministers of government, you can hear from the northern end of Duke Street some horns are being blown and bells are ringing to signal the arrival of the members of the Jamaica Labour Party, will be coming from that end. And in a while, you will be hearing similar support from the southern end from members of the People's National Party. Yes, I said so, and there it was. You perhaps are not hearing the sound just now, but there they are walking up Duke Street, members of the People's National Party. And the support in terms of the noise, they are waiting, they've halted a little bit, and so too the members, the supporters and members of the Jamaica Labour Party, who are now making their way down, just in line with the Jewish synagogue, as they make their way down. And when they do that, they will then go into the House eventually for the delivery of the throne speech. So now there is relative silence coming from the northern end, but there is a little bit of a hustle and cheering coming from the southern end. I can see Mr. Desmond McKenzie in the blue suit coming in. Miss Olivia Grange, she's coming down as well. Of course, the members of the security making sure that the entire place is cleared. We are seeing now the Prime Minister of Jamaica, the Most Honorable Andrew Holness, and his wife, the Most Honorable Juliet Holness, Babsy Grange. And there they are making their way in for the first time as a husband and wife team, along with other members of the... Hello, Mr. Chuck. And, Mr. Floyd Green. Oh, how are you doing? Very good to see you all. Hey, Mr. Pernell Charles Jr. So these are the members of the Jamaica Labour Party who are now... Minister Henry is also in the group at the end of this group of persons from the Jamaica Labour Party who are making their way into Gordon House at this time. Feeling that... They have in fact come on down in such a manner that those persons who are now on the southern end representing and supporting the People's National Party, we will be at any moment seeing and hearing their arrival into this space, which I will call the parade ground. So this 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, has formed the Guard of Honor. And as usual, these men are at their finest So there we have now the members of the People's National Party making their way again. There's a structured, sedate behavior that we are happy to see from the supporters from both ends after the initial sharing and greeting. The leader of the opposition, Mrs. Portia Simpson Miller, with her arm through that of Mr. Peter Phillips. And then we are seeing Mr. Daly, Mr. Richard Azan, and several others, Mr. Peter Bunting, as they all make their way into the House. Miss Lisa Hanna is making her way up now near to the rear of the gathering for the People's National Party, along with Mr. Bobby Pickersgill and others. And so, we still have a few special guests who are arriving at this time, and as normally happens, and they're going in along with the members of the People's National Party, as they did too with members of the Jamaica Labour Party. We are now seeing the arrival of yet another important person. And this would be Lady Allen, the Governor General's wife. Her Excellency, the Most Honorable Lady Allen, has arrived and disembarks her vehicle. North Police is in attendance along with the door openers. And she is wearing peach this morning along with a fascinator, looking quite elegant. So there she is, Her Excellency the Most Honorable Lady Allen, in a knee-length peach dress with her fascinator, being escorted by the Commissioner of Police, Dr. Carl Williams, as she makes her way. And she's also wearing this morning. Very nice. Wonderful to see you, ma'am. So she is turned out in a fashion statement. Hello. The Most Honorable, Her Excellency Lady Allen, now making her way into the House. So we are now anticipating the arrival of the Governor General, and when he gets here, he will be mounting the saluting dais, and he will inspect the Guard of Honor. And of course, the mass bands will provide the music for that. You may be able to recognize the tune that they are playing if you're into folk music. And of course, if you're in the habit of listening to the mass bands or the military band of the Jamaica Defense Force. As a matter of fact, might I just remind you that at 4 o'clock on Sunday, the military band will have their usual display and free concert at the bandstand in Hope Garden. So you may want to attend there. It's usually very pleasant. Lots of ladies going by, and this morning they have chosen fascinators rather than hats. We're seeing there an orange fascinator, a red fascinator, with a cream dress and a white dress, looking extremely nice. So the hats sometimes are difficult to maneuver if you're sitting behind them and they're large, then you can't see what is happening. So the fascinator does make a really superb statement, elegant statement, and it is not a hindrance to anyone. Once again, let me welcome you. It's the official ceremonial opening of Parliament, if you're just joining. Yes, and this, of course, is the Jamaica Parliament, the Houses of Parliament. The members of the Senate have gone in. The members of Parliament have gone in, and still we are seeing special invited guests arriving at this time. And we are always so proud at the display put on by the members of the Jamaica Defense Force. Just look at them, the men of the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment. There are three regiments. There's the 1st Battalion, Jamaica Regiment, the battalion that's on parade, the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, and there's a 3rd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, often referred to as the reserves. That's Guard Commander Major Sean Faulkner belting out those commands, signaling that the Governor General will be arriving momentarily. Order! The mounted troops of the Jamaica Constabulary Force have a very rich history, but they are not just stayed in history. We do know that they still provide a very important function. You see them in the corporate area from time to time, and here they are, beautiful animals this morning. And well-behaved, sometimes they can get a little agitated and have a mind of their own. But this morning, they have followed their instructions very carefully and are walking in sync. There you go. They are trotting in sync. So that went very, very well. And now. So this one is at a canter, looking really brilliant. The men of the Jamaica and women of the Jamaica Constabulary Force showing off the mounted troops that the JCF is so very proud of. I'm particularly proud of the mounted troops, as my uncle was a mounted troop. Yes, so I feel very proud about the mounted troops. And here's our Governor General now walking the red carpet, His Excellency the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Allen. He'll be mounting the saluting dais, where he'll be given the royal salute. The royal salute, of course, you will hear the music of the national anthem.
Royal salute! Reason!
Under the baton of Warrant Officer 1, Albert Sean Hurd, conducting the mass bands, the Guard Commander, Major Sean Faulkner. And now the Guard Commander will approach the Governor General and will invite him to inspect the guard. And let me see if I can lip sync for you. He kisses his sword twice. And then he say, the guard of honor is furnished by the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaica Regiment, in open order with bayonets fixed, awaiting your inspection, sir. And now the Governor General will inspect the guard of honor. The Chief of Staff, Chief of Defense Staff, Major General Anthony Anderson, the Commanding Officer, Lieutenant Colonel Rowan Johnson, the Guard Commander, Major Sean Faulkner, and the piece of music I told you about earlier on. This is a folk song, Lignum Vitae. It's one of the regular pieces played by the mass bands. The color ensigns are very honored this morning. There are two lieutenants who have been given the honor and the privilege of carrying the colors this morning. The maroon color, which is the 2GR color, or the 2nd Battalion, the Jamaican Regiment color, which is maroon, and of course the Queen's color, which is what appears to be the Jamaica flag, but it isn't. And that is why, for example, when the Governor General was on the saluting dais, that flag, when dipped, touched the ground. Its colors. So we've gone into yet another folk song medley, this long time gal. And
this puts a Jamaican stamp. The occasion that Jamaican music, folk music, is used for this. Under the baton of Warrant Officer 1, Albert Sean Hurd, Director of Music with the JDF. And now, having completed the inspection of the Guard of Honor, the Governor General now makes his way back to the red carpet, accompanied by the Chief of Defense Staff, the Commanding Officer, and the ADC General. Governor General mounts the saluting dais once again for... And that simply means a royal salute. The anthem will be played once again, and then he will make his way into the chambers. It is 2 minutes to 11. The activities inside of Gordon House are scheduled to start at 11. The Governor General now leaves the saluting dais, makes his way into the chambers, where there will be 10 trumpeters from the Jamaica Regiment Band who will play the fanfare as he makes his way gets into the chambers. Then we should be able to hear the fanfare that will be given by the 10 trumpeters of the Jamaica Regiment Band. So all in all, the ceremonials in terms of what was scheduled for Duke Street have been completed, and what we are preparing for now is the arrival of the Governor General. Here we go into the chambers. There he is. And as I had indicated a short while ago, that everything was scheduled to start at 11, and the now looking at the inside of Gordon House, the clerk of the houses goes in without the mace, as you would have observed. And the formalities for inside of the house will begin as soon as the Governor General gets into his place. Let me just say it's been a commentary from the outside of Gordon House. The activities of the inside will speak themselves, which you will be able without commentary. I'm Faye Ellington, working along with the teams from the Jamaica Information Service and the Public Broadcasting Corporation of Jamaica. And now, if you could put your attention to the activities on the inside of Gordon House.
I now invite the President of the Jamaica Council of Churches to say prayers.
Let us now unite our hearts in prayer. Creator God, giver of human life, we acknowledge your presence as the sovereign ruler over all the nations of the earth. We thank you for this beautiful island, Jamaica, that you entrusted the unique people that have come to be known as Jamaicans. We acknowledge the gifts, blessings, and responsibilities that are embedded in the nationhood we celebrate and reaffirm on this special day. It is in this spirit that we commit and commend for your blessings our Sovereign Lady Queen Elizabeth, Philip Duke of Edinburgh, Charles Prince of Wales, and all the royal family. Give grace to all who exercise authority in our Commonwealth, that peace and happiness, truth and justice, religion and piety may be established among us. Especially we pray for the Governor General of our island, the Prime Minister, the Leader of the Opposition, the Senators and members of the House of Representatives. Grant them wisdom and understanding that all may work together in peace and in unity for the highest good of the nation. May the policies debated and defined account for those decisions that are true to your will, your purpose, and the good order of Jamaica, land we love. Finally, we commend to your eternal wisdom not only our leaders in Parliament and in the Senate, but all who lead and direct in every aspect of Jamaican life. Guide, protect, bless, and prosper. Lead and direct us all so that Jamaica may grow in wisdom, stature, and righteous relationships to the glory of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Please be seated.
The Constitution of Jamaica, a proclamation by His Excellency, the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Linton Allen, Member of the Order of the Nation, Knight Grand Cross of the Most Distinguished Order of St. Michael and St. George, Commander of the Order of Distinction, Knight of Grace of the Most Venerable Order of the Hospital of St. John of Jerusalem, Governor General of Jamaica. Whereas it is provided by subsection 1 of section 63 of the Constitution of Jamaica that each session of Parliament of Jamaica shall be held at such place and shall commence at such time as the Governor General may by proclamation appoint. And whereas it is expedient that a session of the Parliament of Jamaica should be held at such place and commence at such time as shall hereinafter appear. Now therefore, I, Patrick Linton Allen, Member of the Order of the Nation, Knight Grand Cross of the Most Distinguished Order of St. Michael and St. George, Commander of the Order of Distinction, Knight of Grace of the Most Venerable Order of the Hospital of St. John of Jerusalem, Governor General of Jamaica, in exercise of the power conferred on me by subsection 1 of section 63 of the Constitution of Jamaica, do hereby proclaim and make known that a session of the Parliament of Jamaica shall be held at George William Gordon House in the parish of Kingston, commencing at 11 o'clock a.m. on the 14th day of April, 2016. Given under my hand and the broad seal of Jamaica at King's House this 8th day of April in the year of our Lord, 2016, and the 65th year of the reign of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. God save the Queen.
Honorable members of the Senate, members of the House of Representatives, I now present my government's plans and programs for the financial year 2016-2017. This is the start of new beginnings, a new parliamentary year, a new administration with a newly elected Prime Minister. Jamaicans also have a new hope for prosperity. It is this new hope that forms the foundation for building a partnership for prosperity. We have demonstrated yet again in our recent elections that we can transfer power seamlessly. This must not be taken for granted. Our democratic tradition is one of those things of which we can all be justly proud. It is a tribute to both sides of this honorable house. That an election could have been so vigorously contested and closely decided, but when the results were in, they were accepted. Members of this new administration, as well as the opposition, must be commended by all Jamaicans for again showing the world that we value democracy, that despite the cut and thrust of our democratic system, we accept the will of the people and move on with their business. Jamaica, through bipartisan cooperation and commitment, evolved an electoral system that is the envy of the world. We must acknowledge our collective progress. We must continue to do everything to strengthen our people's confidence in our institutions, as this is the best way to encourage more Jamaicans to engage in the democratic process. Our institutions must work for the people, and citizens must feel that they exist to serve them, to facilitate, and to empower them. Honorable members, there is an urgent need in Jamaica today to build trust. It is important that commitments to the people are kept, because their own commitment to an investment in good citizenship is dependent on our keeping faith with them. We must never squander the goodwill and trust of our people. The restoration of trust in government is a key ingredient in building a partnership for prosperity. You have an obligation to conduct yourselves both inside this house and outside in such a way that commands the respect of all. The Jamaican people have a right to demand quality service from their government. In this regard, this new administration will be accelerating efforts to strengthen public sector efficiency and responsiveness. This Prime Minister must ensure that the members of Parliament are accountable to the people of their constituencies. The first step to building an accountable government is transforming the efficiency and the effectiveness of government. The restructured and smaller cabinet sends a strong signal to the intention of the administration to extend and evolve the reform of the governance system. The government will continue the public sector transformation and modernization program, which is built on three pillars. One, trade and investment facilitation, with the aim of improving Jamaica's trade and investment position. Two, managing public sector costs, which places a focus on increasing efficiency in government and expenditure. And three, government efficiency and service delivery, which targets the capacity of government to sustain the efficient and effective delivery of results-focused, customer-centric public services. Honorable members, in this fiscal year, the following initiatives will be pursued: the implementation of an electronic business registration system, which is a one-stop shop allowing online registration of businesses. Rollout of the trade facilitation program, creating a single electronic window to simplify and automate import and export processes. Rollout of the ICT program, starting with the setting up of the council responsible for approving priority activities. Implementing the human capital management enterprise system, which will be used to make projections in training, availability of skills, compensation, and pensions. This system, importantly, will also ensure that we meet our goals of fairness in the areas of gender and persons with special needs. Government will also accelerate digitization and public records management through its records and information policy. Driving the growth agenda. The government will continue to drive the growth and job creation agenda through debt management, tax reform, pension reform, financial sector reform, monetary policy, implementation of reforms to development applications process, implementation of a new special economic zone regime, trade facilitation, expansion of micro, small, and medium enterprise financing and capacity development, labor market reform, land titling initiatives, implementation of a strategic plan for the outsourcing industry. Honorable members, improving general well-being. Honorable members, the new administration takes very seriously the matter of improving the general well-being of the people. It is an important part of restoring trust in government. In this regard, the government will focus its attention on modernizing the operations of the National Insurance Scheme. The need to modernize the operation of this scheme. The Ministry of Labor and Social Security will reduce pension processing times and will introduce more efficient methods of payment to pensioners, including those who reside overseas. This year, there will be the introduction of direct deposits for new pensioners. greater compliance by employers. A public education program will be launched to foster greater compliance by the payment of NIS benefits. There will be a comprehensive review of the NIS Act 1966. This will address outdated practices and provisions, benefit rates and contributions to improve coverage and compliance and to close loopholes. Drafting instructions will be sent to the Chief Parliamentary Council by the end of the fourth quarter of this fiscal year. The Disabilities Act will be fully implemented this year through the development of the regulations and codes of practice, establishment of the Jamaica Council for Persons with Disabilities as a body corporate, and the establishment of the Disabilities Rights Tribunal. Program of Advancement Through Health and Education, PATH. There will be a review of the benefits under the PATH program. There needs to be greater alignment of PATH with the social needs of the people. The Public Assistance Division of the Ministry will be restructured to deliver more effectively its range of programs, such as emergency assistance, compassionate grants, social housing, transportation, and post-secondary grants to PATH beneficiaries and steps to work. The Overseas Employment Program. There will be an expansion of the Overseas Employment Program to include non-traditional markets. The Occupational Safety and Health Bill will be pursued vigorously this year. The proposed legislation will enable Jamaica's ratification of approximately 34 conventions, protocols, and recommendations of the International Labour Organization. Industrial Disputes Tribunal. An office of the Industrial Disputes Tribunal will be established in Montego Bay, and consideration will be given to adding other regional offices in Manchester and St. Anne. Health and education. Honorable members, education and health are two major areas affecting general well-being. There are several challenges in these two sectors, but the government is determined to work assiduously during the first year of its administration to tackle them. Health. Primary health care will be a major focus, with the administration expanding the public-private partnership approach to various services. Government will also seek to expand infrastructural development as well as access to health care. The health sector will benefit from the crafting of a new 10-year strategic development plan. Government will continue to stress the importance of partnership and community mobilization in promoting and protecting the health of our people, and will be taking steps to improve its capacity to identify and respond to public health issues. Education. A major thrust in education this year will be the implementation of the Alternative Pathways to Secondary Education and Career Advancement Program, CAP. This Alternative Pathways to Secondary Education will ensure that every student is given the opportunity to progress through their secondary education dependent on their aptitude, needs, and potential. The CAP will extend its reach in rescuing and providing a lifeline to many young people who would otherwise become a part of the growing number in the unattached category. The There will be a raft of interventions to support students with behavioral problems. The Ministry of Education, Youth and Information will also have a major focus on parenting education, conducting parenting classes in communities across Jamaica. Expanded assistance through JAMVAT. The ministry will invest more in the Jamaica Values and Attitudes Program for tertiary students, JAMVAT, to assist needy students to access tertiary education. This program is also about the students doing voluntary services and contributing positively to the community. Water. Honorable members, the availability of water is critical to the well-being of a people, but it is also one of the pillars that supports economic growth and prosperity. The government, through the National Water Commission, will engage the Planning Institute of Jamaica, the Development Bank of Jamaica, and the International Development Partners to examine the investment opportunities and develop a schedule of investments through public-private partnerships. Particular focus will be on the following. One, the Rio Cobre Water Treatment Plant development. Two, the Rio Bueno Water Treatment Plant development. And three, the Saltbury Wastewater Treatment Plant expansion. The development of the Rio Cobre 15 million gallon per day, 15 MGD water treatment plant at Content District in St. Catherine is intended to augment water supplies to the Kingston metropolitan area, the KMA. The Rio Bueno project will include the development of a water treatment plant and associated transmission mains with a source capacity of 15 to 20 MGD. This plant is designed to meet the resort development plans for Trelawney, St. Anne and St. Mary. The project will form a part of the larger Northeastern Parishes Water Supply Improvement Project. The Saltbury project involves the expansion of wastewater treatment capacity to accommodate future flows from Kingston and St. Andrew, Caymanas Estate, and Southeast St. Catherine. There will also be a thrust towards developing a modernized Kingston sewer collection system and an expanded non-revenue water program. Housing. Honorable members, the provision of affordable housing for all Jamaicans is a major priority of this new administration. Accordingly, focus will be given to various construction projects during this year. One, Bernard Lodge in St. Catherine. For this project, the government will, in collaboration with a private partner, conduct a comprehensive review of the proposed project design to eliminate unnecessary costs and delays. Secondly, Reed's Pen, Portmore, St. Catherine. Construction of this project will commence during the fiscal year, and when completed, we'll see the delivery of some 148 two-bedroom townhouses for the middle-income market. Shooters Hill, Portmore, St. Catherine. It is expected that construction of 200 studio housing units, priced at $4 to $5 million, will commence during this fiscal year. And lastly, Vernon's Drive, Montego Bay, St. James. 91 and two-bedroom townhouses are slated for this area. Other priority sites have been identified at Ebony Vale and Angel's Pen in St. Catherine, Hopewell Farms in Hanover, Bottom Pen in St. James, and at several smaller sites across the corporate area. At Grange Pen and Ironshore in St. James, housing solutions geared primarily for workers and middle managers in the tourism sector will be constructed. The NSWMA waste management program. The management of waste in major towns and communities across the island has led to serious infestations. $250 million have been provided in the budget to purchase additional waste disposal trucks. The NSWMA has also identified four priority areas for immediate action regarding the management of the authority and the Riverton disposal site. These are: one, the enhancement of the speed with which contemporary financial controls are implemented to ensure accountability, efficiency, and compliance with all standards of financial reporting and the requirements of all statutes governing the authority. Two, the enhancement of the authority's levels of service delivery, with special emphasis on its waste collection and waste disposal responsibilities. Three, the completion of ongoing consultations with the National Environment and Planning Agency, NEPA, and the satisfaction of compliance requirements in order to obtain and maintain environmental certification for the operation of Riverton, as well as other disposal sites managed by the NSWMA. Four, the improvement in the security of the Riverton disposal site through the addition of electronic surveillance mechanisms to the system of patrols, which help to prevent unauthorized access to the facility. These efforts will also serve to address some of the major concerns raised in a recent investigative report by the public defender. We must take personal responsibility for the management of our waste. The government must partner with citizens to build a culture of cleanliness and responsible waste disposal. Tourism. The Ministry of Tourism will reposition tourism to generate higher growth rates in visitor arrivals and earnings. The Ministry will pursue the development of a hospitality college and a craft institute. This hospitality college will train persons at all levels of the tourism sector. Collaboration with Heart Trust NTA and existing education and training institutions will be reinforced to cater to the training needs of the workforce. The Tourism Linkages Hub will be strengthened to create pathways and opportunities to facilitate strong economic linkages between tourism and other sectors such as manufacturing, agriculture, and entertainment. Tourism Workers' Pension Scheme. Legislation is being developed to create a Tourism Workers' Pension Scheme. This pension scheme will be tailored to deal with issues of seasonality, self-employment, and contract work in the tourism industry. Industry and agriculture. The portfolios of agriculture and industry and commerce were brought under the same ministry to positively exploit the synergies between agriculture and industry. The government will transform the agri-park concept to one of an agro-economic zone, emphasizing both the expanded production of primary agricultural products and the appropriate infrastructure to move up the value chain. In furtherance of this expanded concept, the government will this year be extending the Ounslow irrigation system and overhauling farm roads in the Ounslow area to create an agro-economic zone, building on the packaging house and the pepper mash processing facility already established there. A new agri-park will also be established in Spring Gardens, Portland. The severe droughts of the last 2 years demand that we place greater emphasis on irrigation expansion. This year, the government will commence the construction of a brand new irrigation system in Essex Valley, St. Elizabeth, at a cost of US $10 million. Coupled with the New Forest and Duff House Agropark, the expanded Ounslow system and Pedro Plain system in South St. Elizabeth will become one huge agro-economic zone. Transport and mining. This year, the Ministry of Transport and Mining will spearhead the passing of the new Road Traffic and Safety and Road Safety Act, the establishment of the Land Transport Authority, construction of the Portmore Transport Hub, development of the Urban Rural Transport Plan, revitalization of rail services, privatization of the Norman Manley International Airport, and redevelopment of Vernon Field Air Services. In the mining sector, we will see the diversification of the mining sector, revitalization of the bauxite and alumina sectors, establishment of a National Minerals Institute, and the finalization of the National Minerals Policy. The road to prosperity is traversed via integrated transportation systems that are supported by effective, efficient, and modern regulations. Foreign affairs and foreign trade. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Foreign Trade will play an important role in supporting the administration's drive toward prosperity, economic growth, and job creation. To this end, the Ministry will place greater emphasis on trade and investment promotion. The Ministry will leverage our Jamaican diaspora in diplomacy, investment, and trade, strengthen engagement with the diaspora to promote their greater involvement in national development, help ensure that trade is mainstreamed into national development policies and strategies, seek to ensure that future negotiations at the bilateral, regional, and multilateral levels advance Jamaica's trade and development interests. Help to manage and maximize Jamaica's existing bilateral trade relations, as well as relations with CARICOM and between CARICOM and third states. The demand for more effective consular services is growing, and in this regard, the Ministry will seek approval for the National Consular Policy. New departments. The review, amendment, and introduction of legislation and policy in keeping with the government's commitment to international human rights agreements, including the National Anti-Sexual Harassment Policy, the enactment of anti-sexual harassment legislation, and completing the parliamentary review of the Sexual Offences Act are important initiatives that will pursue this legislative year. There will also be the completion of the comprehensive plan to eliminate gender-based violence in the form of the National Strategic Action Plan on Gender-Based Violence. This is intended to protect and ensure the right of individuals to a safe and non-threatening environment free of all forms of gender-based violence. The government is conscious of the importance of males in the maintenance of a healthy society. It is to this end that there will be the establishment of a service and program desk within the Bureau of Gender Affairs to focus specifically on issues relating to men, especially young males. The Ministry of Culture, Gender, Entertainment and Sports, MCGES, has targeted economic growth and job creation, human capital development, social inclusion and development as core tenets of its mandate. Sport, entertainment, culture, heritage are only a few of the areas that will become even further strengthened as drivers of competitiveness and growth for the Jamaican economy. These are areas that will also allow for a diversified export market and can provide for direct and indirect boosts to other subsectors such as manufacturing and agriculture. The government of Jamaica will increase its presence and position in the creative economy through the transformation of our indigenous products and content into cultural capital and the facilitation of entrepreneurship, which can position quality and competitive skills, products and services in the local and international markets. Environment. Government will review existing environmental laws to implement measures for improved enforcement. The thrust towards sustainable development will require a partnership with all stakeholders, such as NGOs, the community, investors, and the government. The key to national development, with a focus on environmental protection, is the recognition that laws and regulations must be integrated, reconciling the interest of development with the necessity of environmental protection. The 2016-2017 legislative agenda. Honorable members, justice is integral for the improvement of the general well-being and to create a prosperous society. The rule of law must apply to all, and we must seek to foster transparency, disclosure, and fair play. You cannot legislate morality, but your legislative framework can send a signal as to your sense of morality. The principles of equality, fairness, natural justice, and transparency must be enshrined in our laws and underpin our legislative efforts. Among the major action items on our legislative agenda for this year are amendment to the Indicome Act, the arbitration bill which governs the conduct of domestic and international arbitration in Jamaica, a constitution amendment bill to replace Her Majesty the Queen with a non-executive president as its head. A constitution amendment bill to address the judicial review of the Director of Public Prosecutions. The criminal justice plea negotiations and agreements amendment bill, which provides for reduced sentences on guilty pleas. The Dangerous Drugs Act, where there will be further amendment to give full legislation to marijuana to be used for the specified purposes. Fixed election dates. Parliament this year will see legislation to create fixed election dates and term limits for the Prime Minister. Impeachment legislation. The impeachment legislation will provide for impeachment proceedings to be brought against corrupt public officials and parliamentarians. The Integrity Commission Bill will establish a single anti-corruption body. The Judicature Resident Magistrate Amendment Bill will provide a right to appeal by the prosecution against manifestly inadequate sentences. This will allow for a retrial if a verdict has been contaminated, for example, by jury tampering. It will also stiffen the penalties for obstructing or perverting the course of justice. Judicial accountability legislation will be enacted to ensure judicial accountability for performance and behavior in office. The Law Reform Notice of Alibi Bill. New provisions will be made for the notice of alibi in criminal proceedings. The Mutual Assistance Criminal Matters Amendment Bill will allow for the introduction of evidence by TV link and video recorded evidence. The National Human Rights Institute, NHRI, will be established in law. The Office of the Public Defender will be enhanced to incorporate the NHRI. Trafficking in persons. Important piece of legislation amending the Trafficking in Persons Prevention, Suppression and Punishment Act will enable the courts to prosecute offences without a jury. In conclusion, honourable members, we must build partnerships in order to achieve the success we hope for. We are partners in the development of Jamaica, and all Jamaicans at home and abroad have a critical role to play in securing a prosperous future for our children. We must join together in building a partnership for prosperity. Our united hope summons the strength in all of us. Jamaicans, a call to action, a call to greater productivity at the workplace, a call for peace and harmony in the home, for courtesy and discipline on the roads, for integrity and probity in public life, for temperance in the parliament. And a call to action to everyone who loves Jamaica and wish its success. I join you in prayer for our blessed nation. We can achieve the best wishes we have for our country, building on the sacrifices of our forefathers and the wisdom of our great leaders. Let us build a partnership for prosperity. God bless you, and God bless Jamaica. God bless you.
Thank you. Council of Churches.
Agenda. Chief Justice.
Because I've always wanted to be able to play like the great saxophonists such as Ace Cannon, Richie Cole, and even our own Dean Fraser. And I also tend to love jazz a lot, and they say that saxophone is the mother instrument of jazz.
And do you consider yourself a good saxophone player?
Maybe. Some people tell me so, but I think I have a far way to go.